Hey guys, welcome to Wake Up Missoula. I'm your host, Scott Raff. It is Friday, April 7th, and it's also First Friday, so I have everything you need to know about your First Friday guide art walk throughout the city of Missoula. There's a lot happening in Missoula. I'm going to be talking about some news stuff. I got dubbing stuff. I got stuff. I got all sorts of great stuff for you guys today, along with Flagship Friday, Teen Talk. They're talking about angst or whatever, something like that. I got some news items. The city is... the Missoula Chamber of Commerce and a couple of the funeral homes here in town are lawyering up against the city of Missoula on a certain amendment to a resolution. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that during city council report on the parks and conservation. But first, let's talk about weather. Currently 37 degrees outside. Your high is going to be 57. Your low is going to be 33. Saturday, you expect your high to be 52, but you have that 70 to 60% chance of rain, hike, and all sorts of things happening throughout your weekend, especially your peak weekend nights. Sunday, you have that 50 to 40% chance of snow and then showers. Sunday night is going to be mostly clear. You have Monday, it's going to be that rainy and snowy mixtures. Yeah, it's just going to be a very interesting kind of weekend, mixtures of snow, rain. It might snow. It might be nice for like maybe an hour or so. If you guys weren't out and about the other day, I walked around outside between 2 and 4, and it seemed fairly nice for as long as it could be. And then apparently by the time I got inside, it started raining. A couple of people came through here and was like, oh, my God, it's raining. I'm all wet and stuff. I was like, okay, cool. Good thing I missed it. Moving on, I got some news items I'm going to be talking about today as well. Locally, many brewery owners are up in arms against a new proposed tavern bill that would raise the cap on the amount of barrels to be brewed. But another tacked-on amendment of the bill would allow 2,000 more barrels and only three location limit to breweries that also have tap rooms that sell the beer. Many problems with having a new brewery is that it competes with local bars that pay for the liquor license. If you don't already know, liquor license, it can go up as high as $500,000 just to get one. And with many places that only sell beer, that brew their own beer, they feel as though that they don't need a liquor license, so they have a kind of like this bill that they have a certain stipend on how much they can sell versus how much they could brew. And that's kind of how it works, is that they can brew X amount, but they can only, like, the way that they can only sell in their tap rooms is that they only brew 12,000 in those tap rooms. But the whole idea behind this one is that 2,000 barrels addition would be basically spaced out among the brewery locations. Moving on, in the state, Governor Steve Bullock vetoed a bill that would ban Sharia law in the court systems in the United States, further cementing the separation of church and state that has been established within America since the beginning. Religion has always played second fiddle to the laws founding that our founding fathers fought against the British twice, and now we have to make sure no religious laws have anything to do with our court systems. A lot of ways... But, you know, back to Bullock's story, he was quoted in saying there is absolutely no need for this bill. Bullock wrote in his vetoed message, asking a proposal could add to the nationwide surge of hate crimes. In national news, House Intelligence Chairman David Nunes says he is temporarily stepping aside from the committee's probe into Russia meddling in the 2016 election as the House Ethics Committee opens an inquiry into whether he is improperly disclosed classified information. House Intelligence Chairman Devin Nunes says he is temporarily stepping aside for the committee's... So Nunes claims that these claims are false. Nunes said that he was in the Intelligence Committee's best interest for him to hand over the new leadership of the probe to Conaway during the ethics panel inquiry. The allegations that Nunes mishandled classified data were prompted by his unusual press conference describing intelligence documents. A White House spokesman told the reporters Thursday night, as far as Trump administration was concerned, this is an internal matter for the House. Moving on, I have some megs for you guys. So these are new programs that are going to be airing on MCAT. It's going to be the Wilderness Issues Lecture Series, Part 3. It's an ongoing series that extended, especially this year. They had an additional 2 weeks after spring break. Usually they end just before spring break, but they had a little extension this year as well because they had so many speakers talking about conservation, and conservation in terms of bills, and also conservation in terms of pro jobs and against pro environment type stuff as well. And then there's also community lecture series where they talk about autism and what to look for in terms of autism. It's a very good community lecture series. You guys should check it out. It's to tell whether or not your child has autism or not. So without further ado, here is a bunch of new things that are happening on MCAT this weekend and tonight on Channel 189.
Yeah, certainly the hope is to meet those populations before they get their adult set of teeth and be teaching them good things. So traditionally, you know, pre-sugar in places like this, decay was very rare. You know, a diet of rice and lentils, you certainly don't get that kind of widespread decay. You get the occasional cavity, but not that kind of widespread systemic decay.
Hello, Caitlin, this is Brady. I was wondering if you wanted to go to Splash Montana.
Sure, I'd love to.
So with Grady's here example, we're using video modeling to show how to plan an activity with a friend. One of the biggest things we do in Yeti is actually learn how to make a phone call. A very, very difficult thing because it takes planning or executive functioning, which involves organization, planning, making sure that things are step by step. It also requires what if no one answers? And so leaving a voicemail. It also requires saying, hey, let's get together, but we have to ask our parents. So obtaining permission from parents. And then ultimately, getting to hang out with a friend. That's a lot of steps all the way through. So this is our first step in trying to teach them how to make a plan with a friend.
I always go to the Fusion concerts, and the Fusion concerts here in Missoula are just amazing. It encompasses a lot of talented musicians that are going through the University of Montana Music Department, and it allows them to kind of express themselves in a fun and engaging way. One of my favorite things is what they do is they open up the grand piano, and not only do they play the piano, but they also bang on the side of the grand piano, but also play the little strings in the back, because they resonate sound in their own selves, and it creates a nice little melody that they've done with that, and I really like how they do that with Chris Hahn, who is one of the many talented instructors at the University of Montana School of Music. All right, moving on. I got some pre-critic for you guys. Here are some of the things and some of the movies that are coming out this weekend that we are plagued with. So starting off with... When the makers of the first movie said, "Ha, remember how hollow the performances those human characters did? Just get rid of them. Just get rid of all of them. And stick with the Smurfs in the Smurf world. Smurfs, the Lost Village. Follow along as we discover the Lost Village of Smurfs that aren't quite the same as the OG Smurfs in this movie that apparently got another theater release somehow. Theatrical. That's what I'm trying to say. Sorry about that. Moving on, your dad's movie is coming out. You know those movies where old people are like, technology, I'm just an old fart generation gap, comes going in style because they use those kind of like technology barrier jokes just to kind of like say, oh, that's how you know they're not like us. But, you know, it's going, the movie's called Going in Style, and it stars all the old people from your favorite movies like Morgan Freeman, Michael Caine. When men get older, they get character, and women get older, they look like the Real Housewives and of a big annoying city. see this movie that puts a bunch of old people in a situation they don't understand, whether it's that it's a bucket list thing, Las Vegas trip, or a last hurrah as they get closer and closer to their death by being old. I know that sounds very morbid and a little darker and pretty bad, but here's a nice lighter note. Anne Hathaway invades a large city of South Korea because her boyfriend broke up with her and kicked her out of the apartment. Hey, if I was a crazy ex-girlfriend, I'd destroy South Korea too, as well. This movie is about a woman who has a direct connection to a giant monster that is destroying South Korea. I'm assuming that the only way to save the world is to have some kind of self-improvement psychological arc before this monster can go away forever. This movie is basically, don't break up with Anne Hathaway or she will destroy South Korea. I'm not sure it's South Korea, so don't quote me on that or anything I say because these are based your own words and opinions on your own common sense. Don't be sheep and go to these movies, basically what I'm trying to say. All right, so that concludes your pre-critic stuff. I got another movie for you guys that I redubbed in dubbing stuff, and this is from the movie Mr. Imperium, which happened in 1951. So when I come back, I'm going to talk everything you need to know about MCAT news, and stay with us. We have Teen Talk and we have Flagship Friday later on the show.
Ah, I like flowers. Mmm. Ah, I can't wait to start singing. La la la. Huh? Who could that be? Boo. Oh. Oh, I didn't know anyone lived here.
I don't mind one bit.
Yufta.
I'm just kidding. I mind just as much as any intruder would come into my home. Who are you and what are you doing here in my home?
My name's Pauline.
My mom's name is Pauline. Or was. You kind of remind me of her. Back when she was young and I was just a boy. She would lock me in the closet and through the keyhole I would see her. It kind of looks like you.
Oh, that's really sad.
Well, it wasn't all bad sometimes. She would give me the crusts of her old sandwiches. She hated the crust. I would eat them all the same.
Oh, so you're still talking about it.
Yes, yes, yes. You know, her cold scowl kind of reminds me of her. Would you like to join me for dinner? Well, you did break into my house. It's the least you can do.
Sure.
And I expect you to be just as mean as she was. It was a classical kind of meanness. Physical and verbal. She would also get the neighbor kids to help out with bullying me. I don't suspect you know any kids, right?
Right. I can only make it as awkward as it is right now.
Good. By chance, could you, like, say mean things to me just off the top of your head? But also, I have some flashcards for you to use. Be nice if you can memorize them by dinner time tonight. But I wouldn't be offended at all if you decided to bring some kids to throw some rocks at me. Do you think you could do?
I said I don't know any kids. I don't know. I just came here to check out what's going on in this house, and you're asking.
Oh, see here. I like that fire. That's the kind of thing I need for tonight. It would be nice to get some kids to throw rocks at me, but I can deal.
What am I getting myself into?
All right, for dinner tonight, I expect you to make sandwiches, cut off the crusts, and only give me a couple of them at a time. I have a particular palate for garbage. Do you think you can do that?
And when do you think I'll be able to leave?
Ah, man. Trick questions. Trick questions. Oh, I hate trick questions.
Hey, Hey guys, welcome back. Now it's time for MCAT news. So if you guys are interested in being part of MCAT or just taking part in volunteering with the Community Access Television Station, you can come on down next Wednesday is our orientation at 5:30 p.m. You can learn everything you need to know about MCAT, how to produce, how to make your own movies, how to make a documentary, how to use a camera, and how to edit your own videos for any future projects that you may want to work on as well. We're a television studio that's open to the public, and anybody who's anybody can come down and enjoy. But of course, you have to be a Missoula County resident, which is usually fairly large. So you can't just be passing through and be like, "Hey, I just check it out." But you guys are more than welcome to come down here. We have virtual reality. We got the Vive, which is pretty cool, and we're more than welcome and capable of showing you guys everything you need to know about some virtual reality stuff as well. Another big thing that we're going to be doing is that we're having a party on May 5th. There you go. So you go to MCAT.org. You can see this nice little logo right here, and you click on here, and it brings you to a nice little link on it and tells you exactly where and when it is. It's on May 5th. From 5 to 8 p.m. at the Downtown Dance Collective, and it's going to be great. You be sure to RSVP. We'll have a piano playing outside of the building, so it's going to be just off of Main Street across from the parking garage in downtown Missoula. And we're going to be raffling off this bike. I know this is a terrible representation of this bike. So I'm going to take off my headset real quick, and I'm going to kind of like hike it up and kind of show you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I want to thank FreeCycles for building that bike for us, and we're going to be raffling it off. You guys can sign up for the raffle by going to MCAT.org. It'll be a nice little pop-up. All you got to do is give us your email and your name. That's it. And we will send your email saying, and we will raffle it off that day. So you have to be there and be like, "Hey, who is John Johnson? I'm John Johnson." Yeah, you win this bike. Woo, sweet bike. But that's everything you need to know about kind of like what's happening with MCAT. There's a lot of other things happening. MCAT will be also doing a VR thing for MissCon. So it's the Missoula Comic Con, but that's later in May. But also we're going to be doing a Earth Day VR type thing at FreeCycles on April 22nd. They're doing a big event there with Missoula Urban Demonstration Project, FreeCycles. I'm assuming there's other things there as well. I'm not entirely sure 100%, but I know that MCAT will be there kind of showing off our VR stuff, because nothing says outdoor biking and activities like going into a virtual world, right? All right, so moving on. I got Teen Talk for you guys. Do I? Yes, it's on the next on the list. So they're talking about some teen angst or other things. A lot of times they start talking about one thing and then they end up talking about another. So without further ado, here is Teen Talk with everybody from my Hellgate High School flagship program.
Welcome back to Teen Talks. I'm Neil Wells. Today on Teen Talks, we're talking about the long-awaited return of Szechuan sauce at McDonald's, as well as teenage angst.
Two things that are totally related.
Yeah.
Right.
Sauces.
So I feel as though I should give some context to the Szechuan sauce. Rick and Morty Season 3 just premiered recently, and quite a central theme in it was how good this McDonald's Szechuan sauce that was promoting Mulan was. And since that aired on Saturday, so many people have been asking for the sauce.
Yeah.
And now it sounds like McDonald's going to bring it back. Does anybody have any thoughts about this?
I don't eat at McDonald's. I have no thoughts. Continue on.
I haven't ever tried the
I've never actually tried the Szechuan sauce.
Well, how would you? It was in 1998.
Was that the last time they had it?
Well, yeah, because it was only a promotion for Mulan.
Oh.
Oh, that Mulan. If I meant the new one. The new one.
They're making a perfect opportunity to bring it back now.
Yeah. I don't know. I can't speak.
I've never had the Szechuan sauce.
Yeah, but are you excited to try it?
I guess I'm excited to try it.
I guess.
It probably tastes different because McDonald's does that.
Like, is it... What is it? Like, is it mayo and artificial?
Well, it's all the pictures I've seen have like teriyaki on it, so I assume it's like teriyaki-ish.
If you want good teriyaki, just go to Noodle Express.
It's not teriyaki. It's Szechuan, but it's got
still,
it probably
it's Szechuan.
Szechuan,
Morty, I need the Szechuan.
Morty.
That was bad.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
I don't know.
Do you think Rick would go to another dimension where they never discontinued the Szechuan sauce?
No, I think he's tried.
Actually, yeah, he probably has.
No.
I was at McDonald's, like, when? Monday, and I didn't see the sauce there.
Well, that's because it hasn't been there since 1998.
I don't know. I haven't seen Rick and Morty at all yet.
But
so.
They kept their pedophile.
You really need to watch it. So it's so good.
It's like just it's great.
Good job. Good job.
Is it on Netflix or
Hulu?
Oh, it's on Hulu. I have Hulu.
Also just Adult Swim's
you can literally look up.
Is that Adult Swim?
Yeah,
like,
it's on Adult Swim.
I got the Adult Swim app, but it doesn't have like all the episodes. I heard that the new episode came out but it wasn't on there. So it kind of sucks because they show commercials, but I mean I want to watch it, so
I watch Metalocalypse.
Do you have Hulu Plus?
No.
No.
I'm not rich.
I have it.
All right. So I think we should move on to our next topic. Teenage angst.
Oh, God, yeah. That's
now, Jack, being a freshman, you're probably very new to this feeling, aren't you?
Yeah, it's getting to me, definitely.
any stories?
I don't know. I just...
Hate.
Describe
hate,
your angst
hate,
for us.
Yeah, hate. It's like every day, and you know, just always feeling it.
Nirvana wrote a song about teenage angst.
Now, let's see. Now we got our slightly older students over here. Tell me.
They're at a party and something like Kurt smells like.
Do you have any experiences with teenage angst?
No, this is going to come to a shock to you, but I'm the chillest person you'll ever meet.
Oh,
John.
Yeah.
Except John, you liar. John's chiller than you.
No, he's not.
Yeah,
I'm
he
way
is.
Chiller
no.
than he is. Dude, he said that to me even.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay, actually, if he said it, then,
Yeah, you little fucking prick. And then
you
just...
Oh, dang it, I forgot that.
Yeah, we're recording here.
Watch your profanity.
That doesn't sound very chill of you.
Okay, well,
yeah, that doesn't
sorry
sound very chill.
That.
Oh, and I like how you said that you're the most chill person.
I meant when it comes to situations.
But then I also
like
how you like claimed
that situation
anger
issues. I'm chill.
Oh, and I like how you said that you're the chillest person, but you also claim to have anger issues.
John has anger issues. Also.
You also have anger issues.
Who's this John, by the way?
He's the chillest
our
person.
Our guitar player.
He's me and Jackson's primary second best friend.
I don't know if he's my best friend.
Oh, is he our guitar player?
Yes.
Okay, I know exactly who that is.
So, Ellen.
Huh?
What are your experiences with teenage angst?
Tolerance, little to no tolerance for, like, modern pop music.
Is that it?
Basically.
That's
like, I hear it in a restaurant or something, or a store at the mall, I'm like, I'm out. Screw it.
That's everybody, though.
Well.
Pop music is
unfortunately.
It is an abomination.
I'm totally joking. I like some pop music. Very little.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind if it just went away altogether.
So, Jackson.
Holy crap, that acne wash worked really well last night.
What?
That's kind of the subject of becoming a teen.
Yeah,
I
but
guess
this is about the angst.
Yeah, I know. I mean,
about
I
the
like,
feelings.
I don't like
man
to cut my hair.
The feelings, man.
I like my hair long. Like,
yeah. I like my hair
hit
long.
Hit me right in the feels.
Yeah, me too.
Hit me right in the feels.
Feels.
Feels
right here.
I agree with Ellen's, like, pop music is generally crappy.
But I don't think that has to do with teenage angst.
It really ticks me off. The only thing that makes me angry about pop music
is like how popular it is and how popular it is because it's like kids in our generation don't know, like, they probably, well, they probably know the Beatles, but they probably don't know, like, the Who or the, they probably know the Rolling Stones. They won't listen to actually good music.
When poser, like, punk bands do covers of old songs because
5 seconds of Summer.
And then people think that they did the song and not the original people.
Wait, let's do the bit. Okay. I'm listening to Owen. I'm listening to Closer. Do the bit. I'm listening to Teenage Angst music.
Well, I mean, Closer. It can go hand in hand. I love that Chainsmokers song. Owen, what's the angstiest song?
What's the angstiest song you listen to?
I'm just gonna be simple.
I can't think of one off the top of my head, I'll just go simple and say Teen Spirit.
Yeah. Teen Spirit. Good answer.
Oh, I have a pretty angry one yesterday, or this afternoon actually.
I'll show you.
It's called I Hate People by the Anti-Nowhere League.
What's up with band names these days? No, it's like Kendrick Lamar, Taylor Swift, these people are the Anti-Nowhere League.
It was like a punk band from the 70s, 80s.
The worst one I think I found so far was Math the Band. Why would you name your band after
Math the Band?
I think they were like really good. Because
they're going to do
like
some calculus.
It's all Nintendo music, too.
All right. So I think we're running out of time here.
Yeah. So let's just end it on this note.
Get Szechuan sauce.
Yeah.
Get it.
This was the worst. Wait, I have one last angsty thought. She moved to Portland.
Who?
What?
It's not important. Okay. Wait, who moved? Your girlfriend? Yes?
I never had a girlfriend.
Okay. We're going to end it here.
Jack.
Get that Szechuan sauce!
Yeah.
Go get that sauce! It's waiting for you. I'm Neil Wells. This has been Teen Talks.
Which camera is it? I think it's this one.
Hey guys, welcome back. And now we are talking about some parks and conservation courtesy of the City of Missoula's City Council Chambers. This winter, the Chamber of Commerce and two local businesses expressed opposition to the city cemetery offering services because it will possibly reduce demand for said services of cemetery services, and mostly in terms of like headstones and other funeral arrangements as well. On January 18th, 2017, the law firm of Milojevic, Dale, and Steinbrenner, representing Garden City Monument Services and Garden City Funeral and Crematory, sent a cease and desist letter to this the cemetery board, copying the mayor and the city council, the cemetery and city's attorneys. Office responded to the letter in January 23rd, and Marilyn Marler, she kind of sums it up way better than I ever could or anyone else could in the meeting, and this is what she had to say in terms of what's going on.
A piece of engraving equipment so that the city cemetery could do some in-house engraving, and city council didn't vote on that, but we did vote to approve a few thousand dollars for staff training for it, and you know, it wasn't a big deal here. It just seemed like a kind of a smart thing to do if we can do some work in-house. Well, turns out that this is a point of contention with some folks in the community who do the same type of work, and there's some feeling that maybe the city shouldn't be doing these things that infringe on the customers of private businesses in town. So that is something that we always are kind of dealing with at city government. I mean, a few years ago we got some criticisms from some construction people in the construction company about how much of the road work we do with our in-house crew versus how much we contract out. Just the other night we bought some equipment so that we could do more in-house wastewater treatment sampling instead of sending it all out to Billings, you know. So that's something that we always have to be mindful of in government, is like, which which should we do and which should we not do. So because some of the different folks involved are represented by lawyers, unfortunately, we were advised not to just meet in private and talk about it. So here we are just talking in public, and I'm glad that everyone can participate, and I hope that we kind of come to an understanding about.
All right, so that was Marilyn Marler kind of giving us a little background on this. Here is Rachel Parkin, and she is a lawyer that is representing, and this is what she comments.
It was pretty well spelled out in the cease and desist letter. Mostly our concern is that the city is engaging in or expanding the cemetery business. They're going beyond just running a cemetery and beginning an actual monument business that is in direct competition with some of our local businesses. And we feel like that, first of all, goes beyond what the cemetery's authority is. So the cemetery board's authority is broad. We'll certainly agree to that, but it's broad in that it permits the cemetery to do what is necessary to run the cemetery and keep that cemetery in good operating condition. Running a separate commercial enterprise like a monument service shop is not part of that authority, and we feel like that goes beyond what the cemetery board is authorized to do. I think most importantly, feel like this engages in a sort of unfair competition, mostly because there's been some problems with the cemetery board changing certain specs. So, for example, monuments need to be a particular size, and when my clients order their monuments, they order a standard size. The cemetery board has begun to do things like reduce the size of the monuments that need to be set, such that the monuments my clients are ordering, they need to be cut down. They need to be made basically custom. This is increasing costs. This is making it a lot more difficult for my clients. And the city has the ability, the cemetery has the ability to provide monuments at a reduced cost. They can give themselves exemptions from some of these specs that my clients don't have exemptions from and things like that.
So. All right, so that was the public comment about how, like, how basically, if you were paying attention, it basically says that there's a lot more loopholes that the city can go through that some of these private businesses that rely on this kind of services cannot. Next up, we got Rick Evans. He's from Garden City Funeral Home, and this is what he has to say.
Regulated by the state of Montana on the perpetual care fund as a private enterprise, and it's kind of a blanket ruling or law for the state of Montana, but the city cemetery doesn't have to follow this particular law. If I were to take the funds out of the perpetual care fund as the city cemetery did, I would be fined or I could lose my license as a cemetery owner. It's very, very unethical. It is very highly unlawful for me to do something like that. The city should follow the same regulations. Even though it's not a particular law for them, they still should follow the guidelines that this particular law for private cemeteries has been in force for numerous years.
All right, so once again, that was Rick Evans. He's from Garden City Funeral Home. Here is Clint Burson. He is from the Chamber of Commerce, and he spoke on the Chamber of Commerce's behalf. Let me see. Just need to double. Oops. I deleted the wrong thing. Okay. So here's Clint Burson.
Your response that the Missoula City Cemetery is trying to offer the same services that the Monument Company and Funeral Home and Crematory are offering. If that's not a business when you're directly competing, I don't know how else to define it. And secondly, it goes on later in the response to say that they'll be responsible for living up to the same standards and ordinances that the monument business and funeral home would be responsible for. So if they're living up to the same standards and they're offering the exact same services, I don't know how else you would define a competing business. So that's the primary concern. The second one, which was touched on by Rachel, is that according to the cemetery ordinances and statutes, the cemetery and the cemetery board are the ones that determine whether or not work is acceptable. So when these private enterprises come in and set monuments or maintain monuments, The group that decides that is the cemetery. If they are also selling monuments and determining whether or not their own work is acceptable, that's an unfair advantage for the cemetery versus the private sector, and that's just not fair competition. The only other thing I'll respond to is Councilor von Vlausberg had mentioned to me last week asked me about the city buying the testing equipment for wastewater and asked me what the difference would be. And at that time, I hadn't given it a lot of thought, so I didn't have a real good answer for him. So as I thought about it over the weekend, and it was actually something I had planned to talk to you about this week, but great opportunity. A difference I see there is that you're bringing that in-house, but you're not going to offer those testing services to other companies outside of the city. You're bringing that purely for the eco-compost wastewater testing. If you were to offer that service as a business opportunity for the city to bring in additional revenue and compete with private enterprise, the chamber would be back here saying the same thing that we're saying about the cemetery. You shouldn't be competing with private enterprise.
All right, so that was Clint Burson, and he was speaking on behalf of the Chamber of Commerce, the Missoula Chamber of Commerce. Any problems that the cemetery has for regulation is already built in, according to Burson from Chamber of Commerce, which prevents any wrongs based on fines to private industries, but a lot of times with a lot of in-city ordinances can be kind of like changed and put more into favor of some of the city stuff, since the city does have a say on what the cemetery board is. So here's Brian von Vlausberg with the final words of the meeting.
Nobody on this committee is an expert in any of the detail stuff that you guys all work on. We passed a revision to this ordinance in July and August of 2014. There was no public comment submitted about the ordinance. We have a process by which, you know, we take public comment and then try to make the best decisions that we can make. Sometimes we do a good job, sometimes we don't. We can't do a good job without written input, frankly. Oral input is also fine, but on particulars like this where it is so detailed, I would highly encourage submission of written input. Otherwise, we see an ordinance revision come before us and with no public input, and it seems reasonable, and we're going to defer to the voices that we hear.
All right, so that was Brian von Vlausberg speaking in response to the letter that was sent in by these folks. If you want more information, you go to ci.missoula.mt.us. It's a great resource where you can watch these meetings and more and learn about what local government does and how it works with the community to help make Missoula a better place, basically. So go to ci.missoula.mt.us. Here is the website. Nice little cute little website, ci.missoula.mt.us. I say it again. You can also Google City of Missoula. So that is basically all the meeting I had for you guys for the City Council report, some parks and conservation. That's kind of like the thing they'll be working on throughout a little while. No official motion was passed. This is an informational meeting only. So they're talking a little bit more about this, and they will be continue talking about this in the future as well. Moving on, I'm going to be talking about your art guide, but first, here's a nice little tease of what you guys can expect from the Missoula. Is it the Clay Studio or the Missoula? Yeah, it's the Missoula Art Museum, and this is featuring Ryan Feddersen, which will be going on until April 22nd. This will be the last First Friday that you guys will get to check it out, and when I come back, I'm going to give you your art guide throughout Missoula. Thank you. Once again, I want to give a nice little shout-out to our very own Rick Phillips, an employee here who goes out to these art museums and gives a little taste, a little representation of some of these art installations at various art museums here in and around the Missoula area. You guys should totally check it out because you only get a tip of the iceberg from these minute-and-a-half videos. But let's talk about some art stuff. So let's kick off your first Friday with explorations in knotwork. It's a artwork by Akilish with emphasis on new knotwork. It's going to be at 5 o'clock at the loft. Most of the things are going to start at 5 o'clock, but I'll remind you a couple times throughout this art walk guide as well. So this is knotwork, explorations in knotwork, happening at the loft. Moving on, we got First Friday with Sheila Miles. This is going to be at the Missoula Art Museum. Ma'am welcomes exhibition Light and Shadow from 5 to 8 p.m. with live music from KBGA, no host bar, and gallery talk at 7 p.m. This is a 20-plus years in Missoula. Sheila Miles earned a reputation as a talented and prolific painter with her introspective and symbol-laden imagery. First Friday events are generously sponsored by the Missoulian. Probably could have left that last part out, but still. This is the next one, is Gap Between Stories. It's going to be at the Frontier Space Gallery. We live in gaps between the stories. It's an art opening. It is a two-person exhibit featuring the photographic work of Johanna Warwick and Christine Thompson. The artists utilize news, images, and materially recontextualize them to emphasize a limitation of photography as a factually complete records of time. Both artists combine analog and digital processes to underscore the ways in which new photographs have been produced and how production affects our understanding of cultural history. Moving on, the next one we got here is a staff showcase at Gecko Design at 5 p.m. They have a very talented team at Gecko Design, and they want to show off some of the projects they've been working outside the workplace, spanning a range from media from photography to music to drones. There'll be plenty of entertainment and something for everybody. Stop by and get some great art, music, and drinks and fun. The next one we got, The Abyss. It is high school graduation art. See some of the upcoming high school artists who are going to be going to art school, hopefully, as they show off some of their art skills. Gallery 709 inside Montana Art and Framing will present a group of senior high school art students from Missoula who are about to graduate and enter the post school abyss, which is what this thing is called, The Abyss. Moving on, we got the next one, which is something I can say on television because it's part of a title, Badass Beauties, The Culture of Rebellious Femininity. Oof. Not because of my pronunciation, not femininity. Anyways, April's First Friday at Betty's Divine will feature a photography of Natalie Boise in her exhibition entitled Badass Beauties, The Culture of Rebellious Femininity. In the ongoing project, Boise's works captures two insecurities, confidences, and struggles, and her own personal experience with the feminine. Through her photography, combined with her subject's work, artwork, and poetry, Boise hopes to reimagine the feminine to be more inclusive of all identities. Swing by from 5 to 8 p.m. at Betty's Divine to check it all out. Up next, we got the First Friday at Berkshire Hathaway Montana Properties. Artist Cynthia Swidler, show title, Walk to the River. I live in the Clark Fork River Basin in West Missoula County. The river being the water center of our beautiful town. Each day I walk past the first homesteads of Missoula Valley, encountering changing seasons, changing light, and a splendid life of the river supports. The show represents moments and life captured during some of these walks, and they will donate, and she will also donate 25% of the profit from the show to the Clark Fork Coalition. The next one we got here is, you got a 6th annual bead challenge. Join for the opening reception from 5 to 8 p.m. Come for refreshments, inspiration, and vote for your favorite piece. Participants utilize a packet of beads and supplies without knowing any contents prior to purchase. They must use all materials in this packet but may supplement it with any medium. This year's theme is Flower Power, and the power and the piece designed to design must be a collar or a chest piece. And that's happening at Bathing Beauties Beads at 5 p.m. The Modern West is going to be at the Artist Shop. This show is about a traditional Western subject depicted in very modern fashions. The paintings are bright yet delicate, and they combine realism and abstraction. They seek to balance between the two, creating a unique painting style inspired by nature and the West. The next one we got here is Katie McChain. It's going to be at La Stella Blue, joined for April's first Friday. Her body of work is a collection of woodcuts from the past 5 years, all naturally inspired. These are original works range in subjects of local landscapes, popular animals, and other organic illustrations that are open to interpretation. Katie is a Missoula-based artist who graduated from the University of Montana in 2013 with a BFA in printmaking. She uses traditional methods of relief woodcuts to create her colorful multi-layer prints. And the final one for your art walk is called Late Night Tea. The Lake Missoula Tea Company. Steer away from the beaten path and join us for some late night tea at Lake Missoula Tea Company. Enjoy acoustic roots performance played by Emily Emmons while enjoying the artwork of Martha Elizabeth. She's a Missoula writer and artist best known for marbling paint floated on thickened water and printed on paper or cloth. The marbled faces of the show live in a fluid universe swirling within themselves. And that's going to be at the Lake Missoula Tea Company, happening from 5 to 8 p.m. All these art guides are happening from 5 to 8 p.m. And there's your art guide and art for your art walk on your first Friday. And now I'm going to have a first Friday video for you guys. It's called Liam the Cat.
Yo, dog, you should buy some Pop-Tarts.
There's this, they're the kind that only has one per package, so no way, man.
No, you should totally just go for it and buy me some Pop-Tarts.
Dude, for the last time, I'm not gonna eat Pop-Tart, and I'm never gonna get you Pop-Tart.
That Pop-Tart will forever be on your head.
No! Check that dog, I mean cat, whatever.
Wait, come back! Problem, man.
A talking cat. I'm listening really high. Wait. You sound like Liam.
Dude, I am Liam. I was turned into a cat by that wannabe wizard guy.
You know, it must be that scientistology thing he's been getting into. It's kind of pathetic that he just, you know, has to join a someone like that. Just to feel included.
Dude, do you think there's a way Owen can, like, turn me back or something?
He knows how to annoy people right now. I don't think he knows how to unannoy people back to humans. But I do know this, I do know this witch, or at least she calls herself a witch. Hey. Hop on. You got yourself into. Should've just gave the man his Pop-Tart.
Well, dude, you see, I only had a dollar, right? And, see, I would've gotten him them, but they were the kind of Pop-Tarts that only have one Pop-Tart per container, so, like, seriously, they're asking for a dollar for this? Like, I would've shared, but...
Yeah, I mean, who splits Pop-Tarts?
Yeah, true. I would've eaten both of them, but still.
I kind of think he overreacted, though. I mean, he turned you into a cat. I mean, it seems a little overkill.
Oh, you know! Ow. Oh, dude, why would you do that?
What? I was thirsty.
Dude, I don't know how we're gonna supposed to find a witch. Like, at this time, it's like witching hour. They're, like, doing their witchy stuff. I don't know. Like, oh.
Did someone say... witch?
I
mortals. I'm Ellen the Witch, your host of The Witching Hour. And today I'm here with two people talking about how a man was mysteriously turned into a cat. So, Liam, how long have you been a cat?
Okay, first of all, I didn't know this was a show, so... And second of all, I don't know what you're talking about, but I just want to not be a cat. That's why I'm here.
Liam, I don't spotlight.
So, you're friends with Liam, right?
Debatable.
Well, at least you're here to support this cat, right? To turn it back into human?
Yeah, I guess so.
Okay, well, let's just skip to the part where you, like, turn me back into human.
Well, that wouldn't be good on camera. Anyways, Jackson, when was the last time you saw Liam as a human?
Last night.
Well, you guys, I brought something very special for you.
You suck!
So, Owen, you were the guy who turned Liam into a cat.
That is correct.
Dude, he just turned me into a f***ing cat. I want to be human, come on.
Oh, okay.
Oh, you can just turn me into a human?
I didn't say that.
Yeah, I told you, he doesn't know how to be annoying.
Why are you always ripping on me like this, man? You delusional tool.
Excuse me, but I'm still a cat over here, and that's a fact.
Well, can you turn him back into a human so he'll stop annoying us to death just like every other cat?
I only know how to cast curses, not repeal them. You know, like Congress?
Whatever, whatever. Well, Liam, you're lucky because today you're getting a little makeover. What?
Will the makeover make me human again?
We'll find out after the break.
You gotta be
kidding. Hey guys, welcome back. I only have a brief time, so I'm gonna go over the events right through you. So today, starting at 10:30 a.m., the creative collage with Leslie McNeil. Les McNeil's creative collage class will show you how to see fabric in a whole new way. I know there's like a huge pause between each one. Anyone can create beautiful dynamic collage. No experience is required. Happening at 10:30 at the Confident Stitch. You got family story time with Mac the Moose. It's happening at 10:30 a.m. as well at the Missoula Public Library. So while you're stitching, you can let your kids ages 4 and older and their caregivers to hang out and listen to some music. Listen to music. That's later. But you have a special edition of Story Time featuring visits by Missoula Parks and Rec Department mascot Mac the Moose. So it's a nice little treat today if you guys are planning on taking your kids to the Missoula Public Library. You also have watercolor painting class at 12 p.m. Experience the pleasure of satisfaction of creating and working with watercolors during this class. You must be 18 and older to attend, and it happens from 12 to 2 p.m. To call them, you can go to 258-3867 and leave a message. Chances are they ask you to leave a message. They won't answer, probably. 258-3867. We got presidential lecture seminar is at the University of Montana at 3 p.m. this afternoon. President Lecture Series seminar featuring Jediah Purdy Robinson O. Everett, Professor of Law, Duke University School of Law, is speaking on ecology and political economy in the history of capitalism. His seminar is free and open to the public, and it's happening at 3 p.m. this afternoon at the University of Montana. I think it's in the Montana Theater. That's usually where they put it. They got Kids Camp Expo at Mismo Gymnastics. You get to check out all the summer camps. And if you're looking for a summer camp for your kids to keep them busy this summer when they're out of school, you can check it out. Mismo Gymnastics from 4 to 7 p.m. And it's free and open to the public. Acrotainment, MCT Center for Performing Arts, is doing performance. They celebrate a 10th annual Acrotainment with the World in Motion, Night and Day, Dark and Light. Come see what's crawling in the middle of the night. Dance with the wind, feel the rhythm of the sea. Reach the starlight as it shines and graceful in flight. And tickets are available through MCT Center for Performing Arts. All seats assigned seating, so you get your tickets to ensure you get there in just in time. And it's happening at 4 p.m. at the MCT. Little Red Wagon Vintage and Handmade Market is happening at 5 p.m. at the Missoula County Fairgrounds. There's all sorts of knickknacks and stuff you guys can buy. It's Little Red Chuck Vintage Toys, so you can check that out happening. Also, for your Friday night, you got this is all just late Friday night, 9 p.m. and later. So if you guys are done doing the art walk and you want to stick around, maybe do a couple Fishbowl Fridays because that's usually what they do. Rot Gut Wines EP release party at Monk's. Blue Collar at the Sunrise Saloon, country music. Drop Culture is at the Badlander. It's DJ, much like Charlie, at the Union Club. Miscellaneous music, cover band type thing. We got live Jackson Holt, War Pony, and New Old Furniture rock music at VFW. Dodgy Mountain Men will be playing at the Top Hat Lounge tonight as well. Here are some of your highlighted Saturday events. Backcountry Hunters and Anglers, Rendezvous 2017. Holiday Inn and Downtown at the Park. 8 a.m. starting at Saturday morning. Last year's success in Missoula. It only seems natural that they follow up with a rendezvous that is bigger and better. It's a national rendezvous that attracted passionate backcountry sportsmen and women across the country. Attend at 8 a.m. starting tomorrow morning at Holiday Inn. YMCA Healthy Kids Day is happening at the Missoula Family YMCA. Free and open to the public. It teaches kids about healthy options in terms of food and drinks. Inca Dica Dinka Do. With Loretta Vizucci is going to be at Living Art of Montana starting at 10:30 a.m. Living Art is a Montana drop-in Saturday workshops with artists. You will be learning basic pen and ink techniques, offering free to adults 18 or older dealing with an illness or loss. No experience necessary. Questions 549-5329. Living Art is a place to create, share, and heal. Wild Walk Costume Making Workshop. Well, the 40th Annual International Wildlife Film Festival is coming up. They're doing a Wild Walk to kick it off. It's a parade. So here's another costume making workshop. If you guys missed the one at the Zootown Arts Community Center, Home Resource will be doing a Wild Walk Costume Making Workshop at 11 a.m. Check it out. It's going to be great. Master Painting Workshop at 1 p.m. at the Missoula Art Museum. This workshop is a wonderful opportunity to work with visiting master painter Sheila Miles. She's also going to be opening an art gallery the night before at the Missoula Art Museum. So you can check it out. It's going to be great. $35, $31.50 for members. Regular, you can register online or call them at 728-0447 to reserve your spot. And of course, MCAT Saturday drop-ins are from 1 to 5 p.m., $10 per kid, ages 9 to 13. You guys can totally check it out. To find out more information, go to wakeupmissoula.wixsite.com/wakeupmissoula. It's a nice way we made you write out twice. And for more information, go to MCAT.org. Thank you for joining me. Go to MCAT.org to register for this bike. And for Wake Up Missoula, I'm Scott Ramph. Thank you.